Good morning. Welcome to Fiesta Grande Community Church. My name is Pastor Ron. We're so honored that you chose to join us today. May God's blessing be upon you today. In just a few moments, we will begin the worship service. Good morning. We have a full crowd and some coming back, and boy, this is great to see everybody here this fine, lovely, beautiful Sunday morning. And I hope all of you have enjoyed the pollen count being high and the allergies out there, because I know I have. Oh man, the pollen has been really high, and I've been sneezing and blowing my nose. So if I blow my nose and sneeze, you'll know it's because of the pollen, okay? Let's stand together and get started with a song. And you can't sing Standing on Its Promises without Standing on Its Promises, right? Okay. Standing on the promises of Christ.
Standing on the promises of God. pray that you would be with us this morning and touch our lives, touch this service today, that everything would be used to your honor and glory as we worship you today. Amen. Amen. You may be seated if you want. Well, you saw the announcements earlier, but I want to add a couple of to that. The first one is this Friday night at 7 o'clock at Harkins, there will be the showing of a new movie called Show Me the Father. And it's presented by the Good Ruby Bible Bookstore. And so if you want tickets, I've got a couple of tickets left. They are $9 each. They were 10, but if you bought 10 or more, you get 10% off. So I got 10% off by buying them early. And so there's going to be probably talking to Ken over there at the bookstore about, so far I think he's got it for about 275 people. So it's one auditorium is going to have all of us. So get there early, about 6:30. And if you have wanted tickets, I either got your money, I need your money, or whatever, and come see me. I meant to bring the tickets today, and I'll go home and get them after the service, bring them back. So that's this Saturday, this Friday night at 7 p.m. That's the 10th of September at 7 p.m. I made the mistake and said it's 10 p.m., but that'd be a little late. Starting next Sunday, church service will have it over in the Saguaro room, Ocotillo room, right across the sidewalk. We'll have that there for 3 to 5 weeks, whatever. They're getting ready now that they've got the place painted. They're getting ready to rip up the floors and redo the floors. So they'll be doing that. It'll probably take them a week or so. And so I'm not sure exactly when it'll start. So we might as well start meeting over there for about 3 or 4 weeks. Okay? Starting next week. Let's sing When the Saints Go Marching In.
Just a weary pilgrim, plodding through this world of sin, getting ready for that city when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in, when the saints go marching in, Lord, I want to be number when the saints go marching in. Up there I'll see the Savior who redeemed my soul from sin. With extended hands he'll greet me when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in, saints go marching in, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in, when the saints go marching in, Lord, I want to be in that number when the saints go.
Marching to that, so anyway, we'll understand it better by and by.
Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways of God will lead us to that blessed promised land. But he guides us with his eye, and according to the dark, we will understand it better by and by. We will understand.
to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Amen. Forever and ever His love endures.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For one the life that's been reborn, His love. Thank you.
praise and glory that you can give him as we worship him today. He that believeth in me, out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. You to descend upon our life and make us whole, Lord. Oh God, through this life we go through, it seems like as we get older and older, there are pains in our life, there's trouble, there's trials. But God, we know that we have an almighty God that we can trust in and we can worship in, because all power and glory and honor is to you today, Lord, for your precious, precious love and grace. Thank you, God, for another opportunity of being here this morning. Thank you, God, for each one that's here and for your presence. We know that it wouldn't be a worship service without your presence here to speak to each one of our hearts today. And God, you know our hearts. You know what's going on in our lives and the things we're going through that we don't even want to share with others. Yet, God, we know that you hear us and you answer our prayers and you give us comfort and guidance. Lord, I pray that you just be in this service. Lord, be with us this day. Speak to our hearts today. God, we know we're living in end times. And it's important to be right with you. God, I pray that you just help us. Speak to us this morning, God. Lord, as we were in the prayer meeting on Thursday, we know that there's a lot of prayer requests that are out there. a lot of people coming down with COVID again. And I pray, God, that you just be with each one that's sick and afflicted today, that you may go in and touch them and heal them, Lord. And those that are either going into the surgery or coming out of surgery, I pray that you just be there in a mighty way with them and give them strength and heal them and help them to recover real quickly, Lord. Lord, I know that we're coming down to the active season here at Fiesta Grande, and I pray that you'd be with those that are traveling, that you would keep them safe and get them down here, Lord, to enjoy the winter, the nice weather down here in Arizona. Thank you, God, for the ones you've already brought back. And I pray, God, that you just be with each of us as we fellowship with one another, commune with one another, and just love on each other, God, because we know that Fiesta Grande is not a place we just live in. It's a place that we have friends and family here, Lord. And thank you for each one that are our family here, our church family. And I pray, God, that you just be with us this day, Lord. Be in this country today as we are celebrating Labor Day. And across the nation and the world, there are people that are traveling. And I pray that you keep them safe as we enjoy this last ditch effort of summer. And that winter comes up, fall, winter comes up. And this is the last big weekend that we're able to enjoy the good weather. And I pray, God, that you just be with us. Again, Lord, be with us in this service today. May you guide and direct each thing that's said through the scriptures, through the music, through the message of the hour, through the prayer, everything, God. May we put aside everything that we have going on in our life and concentrate on you today, Lord, that this service will be to you, Lord. This is a worship service to you, Lord, and may you speak to each one of our hearts today. And I thank you in your precious, precious name. Amen.
Everything, Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince. recipe, says he. Son of man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity. He is the Alpha Omega, the beginning and the end. The Son of God, God of peace, the Lord of lords, he's everything. The Messiah, the Lord of justice, the Son of man, seed of Abraham, second person in the Trinity.
Actually, tomorrow is Labor Day, right? Labor Day, tomorrow. And I read up on Labor Day. As you know, I like to read up on stuff. And Labor Day pays tribute to the contributions and achievements of our work people, our American workers, and is usually or traditionally observed on a Monday. And it started back in the 19th century and was made a federal holiday in 1894. That was just about the time I was born. Labor Day symbolizes the end of the summer, and usually we have parties and get-togethers, and people like to go out camping and their last-ditch effort before they have to go back to work, back to school, back to the fall football season and all the other things that are in the fall. But how do we celebrate Labor Day, or why do we? It said that Labor Day was actually started back in the late 1800s at the height of the Industrial Revolution. It was when an average American was working about 12-hour days, 7 days a week. And despite some of the rules and laws, the children as young as 5 and 6 years old worked in the mills and the mines and in the factories and everything, earning only a fraction of the adult wage that was there. That was discrimination, wasn't it? People of all ages, particularly the poor and recent migrants, often faced extremely unsafe working conditions. So Congress passed an act making Labor Day a legal holiday in the District of Columbia and the territories, and in June 28th, 1894, President Grover Cleveland signed it into law. The Uniform Monday Holiday Act was not until 1968, when all the different holidays were changed to Mondays so the federal government employees could get off a 3-day weekend. You didn't know that, did you?
Sure. Oh,
yeah. So in June 28th, 1968, it was signed into effect for Washington's birthday. Memorial Day, Labor Day, Columbus Day were all fixed on Monday so that give all those guys it off. So even though it's the end of summer, it's the beginning. It's the beginning of a new, for kids going back to school, I know they start a lot of times in August, but it's the new season that they begin that new school year. Queen Victoria once paid a visit to a paper mill. During her tour, she was taken into the rag sorting shop, where men were employed to pick up or pick out rags from the refuge of the City of London. Upon inquiring what was done with the dirty, messy rags, the Queen was told that it was there to be used for the finest sort of white paper. Sometime after the tour, the Queen received a package of white linen stationery featured the Queen's likeness on as a watermark on it, which was accompanying a letter explained that it had been made from the very rags that she had seen on the tour of the paper mill. That's exactly what God does to our lives. He takes this old rag of us and he turns it into something that's that's more beautiful. It's fine stationery that we are, and he puts our watermark. He puts his watermark on us, doesn't he? Amen. I need to show you this. You see these pictures up here? The one in the far left-hand corner happens to be my park model over at 22. And see how nice it looks up there with a nice, beautiful awning and trees around it. And as you look to the far right, you see the collapsed awning. And currently, you see the one at the bottom there without any awning at all. Not very desirable to live in, is it? But damage comes, and we need to rebuild, don't we? We need to rebuild our lives and make it something beautiful again so that I can now rent this thing out. So my place is going to, at some point, have a brand new beginning. Someday it will have that. But, you know, I know a lot of you today, and maybe, I don't know, maybe it's just Linda and I, but whenever we even have somebody come over to play cards, we have to clean up, straighten up, vacuum the rugs, because we're expecting somebody to come in and we want it to be nice. And if we're having a big party, like maybe a Thanksgiving or a Christmas party, don't all of you, maybe even sometimes, I know some of you here, I heard somebody's going to redecorate their kitchen, but people are redecorating, they're painting, they're fixing the cracks in the wall because they want it to look nice, because somebody's going to come over and see and they want their place to be beautiful. Shouldn't we be doing the same thing, getting ready for Christ to come back? When Jesus Christ comes back, shouldn't we have our houses prepared to see him, to let him come and see that? A new beginning for us. Well, now we've read, as most of you have done, you've probably read through the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. If you haven't read the Bible all the way through at least once, shame on you. You need to do that. Pull your Bibles out and read all the way from Genesis 1 to Revelations 22. I forget how many verses. But read that. So today's passage comes from close to the end, and it's Revelation 21, 1 through 8. So if you have your Bibles, you have your phones or whatever you may have to pull out your Bible and follow along as I read from verses 1 to 8. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared us as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God." Amen. He who is seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, and the idolaters and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Heavenly Father, I pray that you just bless this reading of the scripture. May you bless this time together. And we ask this in your name. Amen. So what do you think the central theme is of that scripture we read? As you think back on it, what do you see? Do you see our future home? Do you see the place that God has prepared for us? Is that what you're looking at there as the central theme of that scripture that we just got through reading? If it's so, you probably missed the real theme. Because the real theme is God. God is with us. God has prepared a place for us. We will be with God and we will be his children. The whole theme is actually God. Can you see him there? Can you see him in that? And the first thing is, he is going to make everything new. Everything. Even park models that have blown. Everything's going to be brand new. We're going to have a new house, a new home. Because it says, he says, then I saw, John's writing this down, and he says, a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth have passed away. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down. This scripture says that he is God. He is God who now creates. God has created this new heaven and this new earth for us. And we need to be ready, don't we? Don't we need to be ready for this new Jerusalem that's coming down? I visited Oasis this week and saw a lot of people there, and I thought how close most of those people are, all of them really, how close they are to eternity. And are they ready? But you know, we can look at ourselves here and say, how close are we to eternity? We may not necessarily be here when the eastern sky opens up and the new Jerusalem comes down and we see that glorious day, that new Jerusalem coming down to greet us, and we're going up with all the other Christians to meet the Lord in heaven. We may not necessarily be around for that, which would be great, wouldn't it? Oh, I think that'd be super to be able to be part of that group going up to heaven to meet the Lord. But we're going to meet the Lord someday, and we may meet the Lord way before the second coming. And I was thinking about that this week as I went to visit them. How close are they? You know, when I came here about 2 years ago, actually it was 2 years, wasn't it? When I came 2 years ago, I did not know what I was getting into. And within the first month, maybe month and a half, our first death happened in the park. And I was involved in with that. And I was thinking, wow, you know, we do live in a 55 and older community. And that's the facts. That's what we're going to see. If we were teaching grade school or middle school or high school, chances are you may not necessarily see that happening every day or every week, but we even had one pass away this week. And it's the fact, isn't it? And we need to be prepared to meet the Lord when that new Jerusalem comes down. John, as we read this scripture here that John wrote, he's actually referring back to Isaiah 65 and 66, when Isaiah wrote many, many, many hundreds of years before that. He says, see, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I create, is what God says. For I will create Jerusalem to be a delight and its people a joy. I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people, and the sound of weeping and crying will be heard in it no more. Won't that be wonderful? No more crying, no more pain, no more death. We'll be praising the Lord. No more decrepit old bodies, no more bad leg that I have to, you know, watch what how I'm walking. None of that. None of that we'll see up in heaven. The pastor and the writer, Eugene Peterson, described it as a biblical story began quite logically with the beginning. Now it draws to an end, not quite so logically, also with the beginning. The sin-ruined creation of Genesis is restored in the sacrifice, the renewed creation of Revelation. So if you've read from beginning to end, you've read Genesis 1 says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. That's in Genesis 1, the very beginning. Now we're in Revelation 21, and he says there will be a new heaven and a new earth. Jerusalem is coming down. The old is going to be passed away. There will be no more Colorado Mountains for us anymore. But there will be something else that will be a lot more beautiful and a lot more gracious. So God creates all this for us. And then, I like this, that he comes with us. God will be with us. It says, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. God will be with us. It's not a place that we're going to be going out and have to be in solitary confinement. You know, we're going to have a beautiful home in heaven, but we're going to be only alone by ourselves in this little old home. Maybe beautiful, but we're going to be alone, and we're not going to have anybody around us. And that's not what it says. It says God is going to be there. We're going to be there praising the Lord, shouting. If you haven't got used to shouting yet or raising your hand, you kind of better get the arms kind of in shape, because you're going to be praising the Lord. Amen? The New Jerusalem, and he will dwell with us in the midst. He will be there with us. He is now the God that comes. And then we also read that he is the God who comforts. He is the God that comforts. John wrote, he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more mourning, no more crying, no more pain. Did you hear that? I didn't hear any amens after that one. No more pain. Amen. Let's try that one time. No more pain.
Amen.
Better. No more pain, for the old orders of things have passed away. He who is seated on the throne, he is making everything new. These old bodies are going to be brand new. No more amens to that. Man, you guys are a little quiet this morning. The suffering, everything that's happened to us, all that will be behind us. We won't be sad anymore. We won't see things happening around us and be sad and in pain all the time. No more trials, no more tribulations, no more of that. We're going to be praising the Lord and shouting glory to God Almighty. Amen?
Amen.
We will really understand now how to worship the Lord. We may need to work on our worship skills here, but there will be no more working on it. We will be there. Amen? God will be there, and he will be there to comfort us. Then we read in the scripture that God is there to confirm. He's there to confirm, because he said at the end of the scripture there, that one verse, he says, now, John, I want you to write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. His promises are true. When you have read this scripture from Genesis 1 to Revelation, I got it. Revelation, what's the last verse? 31? 21? 21? Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And it says, the grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. From Genesis 1 to Revelation 22:21, God's promises are true and trustworthy. And so God tells John, write this down. This is important. He's confirming that this is what's going to happen. It's not just a little fairy tale or story or any of those. It's actually true. He's confirming this. And now I like what it says in verse 6. It says, now God says it is now completed. Everything I have said, it says it is done. It is finished. Remember Jesus on the cross, one of the last phrases he said, it is finished. The plan of salvation is now complete. Well, now in Revelation 21, God is confirming that the whole plan from Genesis to Revelation, all of that is now complete. Heaven has come down, the new heaven and the new earth, our new home, eternity, all of that is now completed. Wow. It's done. It's done. Behold, I'm making everything new. All of his promises that he's ever said is now completed. We no longer have to, you know, day and night we may look at God's promises. I know if you're like me, I like to read the scripture, and as I read through one of his promises, I said, oh Lord, thank you for that promise. God is going to heal this person or me. I'm not going to go through this allergy season forever. God's going to heal me of this allergy, and it's going to happen. It's going to happen. All of the ailments we have, all the things, we're going to be healed. We may not be healed the way we think we ought to. It may be when God takes us to heaven, but it's all going to be done. His promises. So day by day, we look at promises that God has said, and we are looking forward to some of those promises being fulfilled. But in this day, all of God's promises have now been fulfilled. That's what he's saying. It is done. I'm the Alpha. I'm the Omega. I'm the beginning and the end. Did you like that song that I played? The Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I am everything in between. Everything. The song said, he is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the Son of God, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He's everything. Messiah, Jehovah, the Prince of Peace is he, Son of Man, Seed of Abraham, the second person in the Trinity. Amen. He's all of that. So God is there, and he completes that. Then it says, God is going to cover everything. It says, to the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. God's going to provide everything that you possibly need. You won't have to go to Fry's and buy a big case of water to drink. It'll all be free. That water that he gives you, that you will no longer be thirsty. Amen? He will cover everything. We're going to be satisfied forever. How long is forever? Beginning and the end. As far as east is from the west. Amen? He is God who covers everything. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but will live forever. Then we read that God is the one who calls. It says, he who overcomes will inherit all things. He's an overcomer. He's the conqueror. And we need to stand firm to that. We need to stand firm. As you know, I've been doing the Beatitudes. And my plan was to do the Beatitudes. But after something that Tony said last week, God's been working on me, and when I came down here last 2 years ago, I think I've told this story before, but I'll tell it again. I didn't want to be a pastor. That was the farthest thing from my mind. And then when I woke up in the middle of the night and saw a congregation full of you out there, I knew I had to. And folks, I need to make sure I can't save any one of you. I can't save anybody else in the park or in the city or in the state. But I've got to do what God tells me to do. And that's to preach the gospel. No matter what it is, how it makes you feel, I need to preach it. And I come here on Saturday. Please don't take this. I'm not bragging. But I come here on Saturday. And even Sunday morning, I sit there and I look through and I see Cecilia and Kara. Where's Kara today? She's not here.
She has allergies.
Oh, I'm sorry. Allergies. Yeah. And I see them down there. They're here every Thursday to pray. And I know they're down here praying for me. You guys are too, but I see them right there. I see Rosie. Dear Rosie sitting down there, faithful as can be. I was telling somebody the other day how during the, when we were having to meet outside and meeting here, we're having so many services a weekend, she's here for everything. I see all of you. I don't see you really because you and Mary haven't been there. But I look around, I see Bob and Betty, I see Sharon and Deb, and I look around and I see everybody sitting around, and I pray for each one of you that God will keep you firm and keep you steady in His Word. Because now is not the time to give up. Christ is coming back soon. And we can't slip and falter. We don't have any time to do that. And we need to stand firm to what God says. There is a new Jerusalem. There is a heaven and earth coming down, and the old is going to be passed away. It won't look anything like it is here today. Because God's created something new and beautiful for you and I. If you stand firm. If you stand firm. Because judgment day is coming sooner than you think. I said earlier, you may not be here when the heavens come down and we meet the Lord in the air, which would be so, wouldn't it be neat to see all the graves open up and those that have gone before us in Christ are raising up and to meet us in the air to meet Lord Jesus Christ in the eastern sky. Wouldn't that be cool to be part of that? If you thought about it, that's going to be cool. Yet we may be the ones that are raising from the grave that are meeting Him. But we need to be prepared morning, night, and in between. Because verse 8 says, but the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexual immoral, those who have practiced magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. That will be the second death. If you are not ready to meet the Lord today, you got two choices: to meet the Lord or spend eternity in that fiery lake of fire. That fiery lake. Are you ready today to meet the Lord? Because our future is now. You know, when we were young, we had no worries, no thoughts, no pains, no new knees, no new hips. We were all new. But someday we're going to have a new body and we're going to be in the new Jerusalem praising the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
In 2 Peter, he says, and by the same word, the present heavens and earth have been stored up for fire. They are being kept to the day of judgment, when ungodly people will be destroyed. But the day of the Lord will come as an unexpected, as a thief. Then the heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and the very elements themselves will disappear in fire, and earth and everything in it will be found to deserve judgment. Folks, judgment is coming. Be prepared. Be prepared. In Revelation 2 and 3, God's talking to the seven churches of the apocalypse. At the very end, he says, Whoever hears, let him hear what the Spirit says. Are you listening to what the Spirit says to you this morning? There's going to be a new beginning for each one of us. Wow. I'm looking forward to that. Amen. Our hope is always in the cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, God, that you've gone to prepare a place for us. And we're going to meet you someday. But right now, God, we need to stand firm and believe and trust in you. Trust in the blood of Christ that was shed for each one of our sins. And that help us to stand firm and trust in you, God. Because what you say, your promises are true. And someday we will be saying, it is finished. All life here on earth and our new beginning, our new life in heaven, will just be beginning 1,000 years from now. Thank you, God, for sharing with us today. And I ask these things in your name. Amen. Rosie, would you lead us in the Lord's Prayer? If you all stand with us. Several years ago in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada, George and Verna Budzinski, their lives have been changed forever because on March 16th, 1989, a very normal Thursday morning, the phone rang at 9:15 a.m. There's been an accident, they're told. It involved your son, Ben. As they approached the intersection of Adelaide and Samoka streets near the high school, they could see the flashing lights of the police cars and the ambulance units. Vera noticed a photographer and followed the direction of his camera lens to to the largest pool of blood she had ever seen. All she could say was, "George, Ben is home. Home to be with our Heavenly Father." Her first reaction was to jump out of the car, somehow collect the blood, and put it back in her son. That blood, for me, at that moment, became the most precious thing in the world because it was life. She says, "It was the life-giving blood, and it belonged in my son, my only son, the one I loved so much." The road was dirty, and the blood just didn't belong there. George noticed that cars were driving right through the intersection, right through the blood. His heart was smitten. He wanted to cover the blood with his coat and cry, "You will not drive over the blood of my son." Then Vera stood, for the first time in her life, one of God's greatest and most beautiful truths. Why blood? Because it was the strongest language God could have used. It was the most precious thing he could give, the highest price that he could give. Hebrews says, "But when Christ came as the high priest of good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that was not made with human hands." That is to say, it was not part of creation. Communion reminds us now of the cost that Jesus Christ paid for each one of our sins. His life-giving blood that flowed from Calvary. Heavenly Father, I pray that Ben's life was shed, and the blood was on that dirty, filthy street, we remember, God, that of the blood that flowed from Calvary for each one of us, because your blood and Jesus was broken and beaten and bled for us. Amen. As we partake today of the elements, Matthew 26 says, "While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, saying, 'Take, eat, this is my body. Take, eat, and be thankful.'" Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of it. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink, and be thankful." Thank you, Heavenly Father. May these gifts of your blood and your body that was broken for us, may we remember them each and every day. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing song. I've mentioned so many times about us being not only friends here in the park, but family. And I like this song that we've been closing with for quite a bit. "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God." Aren't you? Let's sing that. "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family of God." And as family members, I love you guys. And go today in peace, and may God's blessing be upon you as you go out the doors. And you remember, there's not a sign there, but as you walk out the door today, you're walking out into a mission field. Amen? You're dismissed.